Hello children, hope you are keeping well. Today in this e-class, we are going to learn social science lesson number 7. Name of the lesson is Women and Reform from the History part. The key points that we are going to learn in this lesson are position of women in the early 19th century. Second, beginning of women's reform, impact of the reform movement. Let's start the lesson. First one, position of women in the early 19th century. In India, the 19th century was marked by the movement for social reforms led largely by men, but focusing more often than not on questions relating to women. The focus of these social reformers was mainly on the obscurities, cultural and religious practices such as child marriage, widow emolition, and polygamy, which were sought to be banned. They also called for education for women and new laws to be put in place to protect women against these age-old practices. First, we discuss about female infanticide. Female infanticide is the deliberate killing of newborn female child. It was not just the poor who discriminated against the girl child. Even the well-to-do sections and the upper caste were equally guilty. Female infanticide was a regular practice. Now let's learn about child marriage. Children in traditional India were married off at an early age. Girls were often seen as a burden, as huge dowries had to be spent on their marriages. Moreover, it was felt that the older they remained unmarried, the more difficult it would be to get groomed. Some girls were married off at as young as 5. This practice led to the mortality rate of women rising, especially during childbirth, as they themselves were too young to bear children. Next, sati system. Traditionally, women were expected to treat their husbands as gods and obedience of wives to husbands remained a strong social norm in the 19th century. This expectation of devotion made many wives follow their husbands to the grave and immolating themselves in the husband's funeral pyre. Polygamy means custom of having more than one wife. Society in India is patriarchal. Patriarchal means society that is controlled by men. Society in India is patriarchal in character, and all the social customs and practices evolved as ways to benefit men. It was normal practice for men to have more than one wife as it had legal sanction. These practices deprived women of their customary rights and freedom in marriage. Condition of the widows. Widows were not allowed to remarry, not even if they were deprived at a young age. They were forbidden from joining any festivities. They had to follow a strict dietary norm, which comprised mostly of low nutrient foods. Widows were often made to feel as outcasts. Now, access to education. Women in this period of time had no access to education. They remained in the dark about their rights. So they were constantly subjected to exploitation, exclusion, and subordination. Women were subjected to a systematic denial of rights to education, training, land, and livelihood resources. This resulted in the exclusion of women from all socio-economic and political fields, such restrictions made women face a condition of near enslavement. Now come to the next point, that is beginning of women's reform. The obstacles faced by women were challenged socially and driven politically. But the reforms were not impolitical in nature. Its main aim was to fight for basic human rights being made accessible to women. The social reformers did not negate, means undo, to the prevailing traditional conditions, but just sought to change certain unreasonable aspects of Hindu society. Thus, in the early 19th century, a series of social reforms followed. First one, ban on female infanticide. Lord Wellesley banned the religious custom of child sacrifice in Sagar Island or Bay of Bengal. Though the ritual practice was stopped, the less visible practice of female infanticide continued unstoppable in western and northern India. In this region of west and north, landowning high caste families found it difficult to get suitable grooms for their daughters or pay high amounts of dowry. So they used to secret killing of female offspring at the time of birth. The talks of a legal ban on these practices, that is killing of female infanticide, were stopped by the revolt of 1857 and were kept on hold. It was only in 1870 that the Female Infanticide Act was passed by the Viceroy Council. However, even after that, there were reports of abject neglect of the female child resulting in mortality which could not be detected or prevented by law. Next, prohibition of sati. The great achievement that Raja Ram Mohan Roy is remembered for is abolition of sati. It was a social practice that was prevalent in India since the ancient times. However, it was practiced only by Rajput princely families in Rajasthan and Central India and in the Vijayanagar Kingdom. During the British time, it revived on a much wider scale in Calcutta and region around it. Here, it became a norm, not only with the upper caste, but also with peasantry and the intermediary caste. The Christian missionaries were the first to attack this practice, but it was under Raja Ram Mohan Roy that the movement gained momentum. Finally, Governor General William Bentinck prohibited sati in 1829 by a government regulation. Now come to widow premarriage. Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar took up the cause of widow remarriage. The Hindu Widow Remarriage Act of 1856, however, failed to make this practice socially acceptable. He failed in getting widows remarried as it involved social consent and a change in the mindset of the people. As a result, the practice of widow remarriage remained rare and exceptional among the educated classes of Bengal. In Western India, where as early as 1841, an anonymous Marathi Brahmin reformer had advocated for remarriage of infant widows. This did lead to some awakening among the Western educated middle class in the 1860s. But the movement of widow remarriage did not gain much momentum, and by the end of the century, only 38 widows had been remarried. By the end of the century, even among the lower castes, widows were not encouraged to remarry. This made social reformers like Jyotiba Phule attack the concept of celibate widowhood. Celibate means abstaining from marriage and sexual relations. The reform movement in the Madras Presidency in support of widow remarriage was started by Veera Salingam Pantalu. He founded a society of social reform in 1878 for this purpose. The first widow remarriage in this region was officiated by him in 1881. Now let's start with child marriage. In Bengal, Vidyasagar continued his reform movement, directing it against polygamy and later child marriage. He finally secured the Age of Consent Act in 1860. The act fixed the age of consent for the consummation of marriage at 10 years of age for women. It was raised to 12 years by a legislation passed in 1891. However, census statistics show that child marriages continued to be widely practiced among all social segments alive well into the 20th century. Now come to the third point, that is impact of the reform movement. This movement saw the rise of such women as Tarabai Shinde, Ranabai, Anandibai Joshi, Rajkumari Ambit Kaur, Sarojini Naidu and Muthulakshmi Reddy, who contributed significantly to the national movement as well as to women's liberation. However, from an overall perspective, reform through legislation remained generally inactive. These reforms affected only a few women belonging to the upper classes mostly, and that too in a restricted way. For the most part, women remained recipients of male patronage. This also signified the patriarchal control of the educated male over the private sphere or the domestic arena reserved for women. Now, before winding up, let's discuss some women reforms movement in Bengal and Maharashtra. Let's start first Bengal. Bengal became the pioneer of the social religious reform movement. A radical trend arose among the Bengal intellectuals in the 19th century to reform society of its social evil. Many schools for girls were opened at this time everywhere in India, but the lead was taken by Bengal with the opening of a girls' school in Calcutta by J.E.D. Bethune in 1849 called the Bethune School. Begum Rukaya was another noted social reformer who championed the cause of women in Bengal. She advocated for education of women and support for their participation in all spheres of life. She channelized her efforts mainly towards Muslim women who were confined under the parda system. Now let's discuss about the reform movement in Maharashtra. In Maharashtra and parts of Western India, the lead in reforming the condition of women was taken by people like Mahadev Govind Ranade, Ramakrishna Bandarkar, Jyotiba Phule, and Pandita Ramabai. In Western India, Jyotiba Govind Rao Phule, popularly known as Jyotiba, did much to reform the plight of underprivileged women and the widows. He founded the Satya Shodhak Samaj in 1873, which was open to all classes, including women. Jyotiba and his wife, Savitri Phule, opened many schools for girls in and around Pune. Thank you.